visitors. Thank you for inviting me to speak to you today. My name's Fred Phillips, and I haven't attended a regional science conference in more than 20 years. My career took a turn toward technology management, and I've bridged the two disciplines by focusing on technopolis, which is the study of what generates and maintains technology-intensive, innovative regional economies. However, knowledge and its instantiation into technology innovation now pervades every aspect of management and geography. And today, this fact lets me close a career circle by speaking about technology at a regional science conference. It's a special honor to be invited to give a keynote talk when my professor is in the audience. Kingsley Haynes, give a wave. Kingsley was on my doctoral committee. So I would like to address the rise of the knowledge society and how its progress affects patterns of spatial activity. The knowledge and digital transitions and the backlashes against them result in many kinds of spatial tensions and in renewed migrations. So I'll detail several of these and venture a few predictions, or at least some directions for research. Let me tell you what I mean by the knowledge society and knowledge revolution. Earlier this year, employees of Google and of several other US high tech firms insisted that their CEOs should not engage with the newly elected President of the United States, Donald Trump. There we go. And the CEOs complied. Can you imagine, first, that the power in knowledge-intensive firms flows from the bottom up and not from the top down? And second, can you imagine that the CEO has to explain to the board on which the company's capital investors sit why he or she cannot control employees? And indeed, that control is an outmoded concept. Replacing knowledge workers is the biggest headache for firms. It's a far cry from the days when employees were hired for their muscles and were interchangeable and easily replaceable. Knowledge workers are not easily replaceable. This even affects corporate location decisions. If you've been involved in industry, you've probably been exposed to an experience like I had when I worked in industry, where the company wanted to relocate its headquarters away from the central city, hired a location consultant, much song and dance, and finally, the consultant's report recommended a location 1 mile from the president's home. It looked quite common back then, but it's not going to be that way now, because companies, knowledge-intensive companies, need to locate in areas where the quality of life and the educational opportunities for the knowledge workers are plentiful. So the knowledge economy, or what Peter Drucker called the post-capitalist economy, is here for certain, but how did it arrive? A little history. Although Karl Marx, most commonly remembered for insisting that the rise of the proletarian labor would destroy capitalism, Marx held a parallel but seldom cited theory to the effect that knowledge would blow capitalism sky high. Okay, this is not me talking as a leftist or anything. This was Marx's words. Knowledge will blow the capitalist system sky high. So Marx was the first one to write that, quote, knowledge has become a direct force of production, unquote. That's an observation that Frederick Taylor would first put into industrial practice 40-some years later. And isn't it remarkable that Marx not only anticipated the rise of knowledge as a factor of production, but connected it to what he called social relations, and that foreshadowed the socially networked innovation that drives our lives today. Joseph Schumpeter then put forward innovation as the driver of the economy, and innovation, of course, requires knowledge. That observation somehow did not penetrate economic models in the subsequent decades. Although they're both remembered as economists, Schumpeter and Marx emphasized sociological forces in that. Those ideas also dropped out of economic theory. Yonaji Masuda was one of the pioneers of computerization in Japan. He authored Japan's first computer white paper in the mid-1960s and developed a plan for the information society in Japan, which was subtitled The National Goal Toward the Year 2000. And his best-known book, published in English as the Information Society as a Post-Industrial Society, caused a lot of head-scratching in the West. Schumpeter's protege, Peter Drucker, writing in 1993, placed the modern beginning of the knowledge society in the post-World War II years, citing America's technological advances of the war years and the determination of the post-war Japanese government to collect knowledge as a resource, making Japan the first non-Western nation in modern times to become a great economic power. I need a moment to open this water bottle. But as a trigger for the modern knowledge economy, Drucker writes, quote, "My own candidate would be the American GI Bill of Rights after World War II, which gave every returning American soldier the money to attend a university, something that would have made absolutely no sense only 30 years earlier at the end of World War I," unquote. So naturally, the internet in the 1970s, the World Wide Web in the 1990s, and especially the more interactive Web 2.0 in the early noughties were key advances in the knowledge economy. In the 90s, we had Nonaka and Takeuchi's book, The Knowledge Creating Company, and Peter Senge's book on the learning organization. Bill Gates in 2001 saw the digital nervous system as the heart of thinking and collaboration in the workplace, and at the boundaries of the business. Then Tom Friedman in 2016, Tom Friedman of the Flat World fame, argued for 2007 as a key transition date in the knowledge economy. In late 2006 and early 2007, here's a list of the things that entered our lives for the first time. The first iPhone, Facebook opened itself to non-university users, Twitter, Hadoop, Amazon Kindle, Google's Android OS, Watson AI from IBM, Airbnb, GitHub, change.org, and the cloud. They all took off in 2007, and that was also the year when global internet users passed 1 billion. Okay, then of course 2017, when Google employees took charge of the company's stance toward the White House, that was another key milestone in the knowledge economy. So you've probably read in the trade magazines that the Internet of Things plus autonomous vehicles plus 3D printing plus robotics are going to cause a massive market disruption. But the knowledge economy is far more profoundly disruptive. It changes the very nature of our economic systems and our societies. So it's the new importance of knowledge and not any particular technologies that drives this deep disruption. Digitalization facilitates and accelerates the transition in that much knowledge can be transmitted digitally at essentially zero marginal cost, and much other knowledge can be embodied in artificial intelligence. So make no mistake about it, the traditional production function is dead. Drucker placed knowledge as the premier new factor of production. So if you're still solving equations with land, labor, and capital, we're missing something. Okay, what does all this mean for regional science? Yeah, land, labor, and capital were the traditional factors of production. And now we've added knowledge to those three. Geographers and urban planners deal with land, so I could joke that you've been demoted from 33% importance to 25%. The truth, though, is that the effects of the knowledge revolution open vast new vistas and research questions for your fields. One consequence of the knowledge revolution is the growth of the sharing economy. People now borrow from each other instead of buying, and you can imagine what this does to the retail landscape. In fact, I have a picture of what it does to the retail landscape. These are abandoned shopping malls in the United States. Another consequence is the general dematerialization of daily life. We have digital substitutes for so many activities that used to require stuff. For example, the world's largest movie house, which is Netflix, doesn't own any cinemas, doesn't distribute to any cinemas, and you can easily figure out what that does to Main Street. One futurist newsletter notes, quote, in connection with dematerialization, the newsletter notes that when we consider the Internet of Things from the perspective of disappearing products and the increase in new digital service models, we can conclude that it is, in fact, the Internet of No Things, end quote. Urbanization and knowledge and globalization can't be separated. People move to the city for much the same reasons that they always did: access to information, access to variety, access to contacts. But the city is now a richer information environment than it ever was before. In the countryside, with its sparse population, it's much easier for people to cling to the delusions that a prosperous but unconnected future is possible, that people unlike themselves are dangerous, that public education is unnecessary, and that individual rights are more important than our need to depend on each other and our ability to get along with one another. City dwellers are connected, though, and that means globally connected. Global connections imply intercultural exchange. City dwellers can use social media to leverage intercultural vitality for innovation, or they can use it to reinforce each other's fears, or they can use it to look at cat pictures. Okay. But many city dwellers do the first one of those, and that makes cities the modern drivers of innovation. In fact, we hear a lot these days about open innovation, and I would submit to you that cities are possibly one of the oldest and possibly the oldest example of open innovation, and today are by far our biggest example of open innovation. So we can see the recent American elections as a conflict between the growing importance of the knowledge economy versus America's long tradition of anti-intellectualism. The backlash against the knowledge society took the form of the election of Donald Trump. Trump voters were mostly rural, and these voters don't like to be called stupid, and indeed they are not stupid. Many are thoughtful people who voted for the candidate they considered less objectionable at that time. But I stand by my general characterization of rural Trump voters as deluded about the future and somewhat maladaptive for it. The information-rich cities imply a digital divide that will accrue more wealth for the metropolises relative to the boondocks, and this may well worsen the political divide. That divide will color decisions about investment or communication bandwidth infrastructure versus hard infrastructure like roads and bridges. There may be some compromises and workarounds that involve drones, but this is a controversy that my regional scientist friends may wish to attack. The political divide, as you've probably been reading, harms America's image abroad. At present, 30% of all entrepreneurs in the U.S. are foreign-born, and nearly 80% of all the intellectual property in the U.S. in the high-tech sector, which is telecom, healthcare, and or rather telecom life sciences and semiconductors, has its origin in foreign-born entrepreneurs. So America is, at the moment, the world's font of innovation, as Michio Kaku and Bernie Sanders have both noted on YouTube. The flow of innovation depends on immigrant brains and initiative. Headlines like Forbes magazine, like "Is Brand America Tanking?" anticipate an America that's less attractive to entrepreneurial migrants and thus a less vibrant innovator. So it's no secret that China sees this as an opportunity. That's the root of Trump's troubles with China, as well as the motive for another magazine, The Atlantic, to publish an article titled, "What a World Led by China Might Look Like." So China might succeed in becoming the world's innovation leader, and it might not. Later I'll mention some of China's challenges in this regard. But China, as the world's manufacturing center, has already changed global logistics patterns, which is a topic of much interest to geographers. As low-cost manufacturing moves to Myanmar and Vietnam, China is putting greater emphasis on logistics with its new Silk Road initiative that they call the One Belt, One Road. Now, building railroads and ships is not what we call knowledge-intensive, innovative work. We've known how to build roads and ships for a very, railroads and ships for a very long time. The One Road, One Belt initiative rests rather on financial innovation. China has started a new international bank and persuaded Central Asian countries to join this bank. Yeah, I was in Iran a few months ago and joking with a colleague there that Mr. Trump wants to build a wall and have the Mexicans pay for it, and China wants to build a railroad and have Iran pay for it. He saw the humor in that, but you know, we both understand, number one, that railroads are useful and walls are not. But it's no joke in Pakistan, because Pakistan has already fallen deep in debt to China over this project and their membership in China's new transnational bank. Okay. The South China Morning Post out of Hong Kong has really excellent infographics explaining the One Road, One Belt project, and also infographics about the hundreds of new cities that China is building. Okay, it's regional science there for sure. So China's building hundreds of new greenfield cities. Many of them are intended to be high-tech centers, or smart cities, or both. And they're building these cities faster than the map makers can keep up. So I've mentioned urban-rural tensions, east-west tensions, globalist versus anti-globalist tensions. We're also going to see resentment in the future and possible revolt over what's called digital neo-feudalism, in which Silicon Valley, California knows everything about everybody and taxes every online activity. Let me restate that. Every new app and new platform, no matter how helpful it is to you, the end user, allows the platform to rake off information about the transaction, information about you, and a monetary commission. So right now, this bounty flows only to Silicon Valley, to Shanghai, and a very few other locales where investors place heavy bets on winning the platform wars. So this is indeed a new kind of feudalism, and we'll see how long people tolerate that. So as the innovative activity moves further into services and away from products, big manufacturing campuses in the suburbs are no longer necessary. Tech startups, the startup firms that service the tech startups, the incubators, and even the research and industry parks are moving into the city centers. And this introduces complications. When Their children reach school age, young families want to move back to the suburbs. And meanwhile, as in the case of Silicon Valley, workers invading San Francisco, rents rise, longtime residents are displaced, and distinctive and precious urban cultures like San Francisco's, which are great draws for tourists, become diluted. And at the national level, technology executives want Congress's attention, but they're not getting it because tech is not located in most congresspeople's districts. We know they're clusters. This is made worse by lazy VCs, venture capital investors, because these VCs know they need to tap the innovative potential of smart people who do not live in San Jose or Austin or Seattle. But the VCs still insist that companies they invest in have to move to where the VCs are. And other investors won't buy stock in tech companies headquartered outside the US. So given what I've said so far, these attitudes are clearly not sustainable. And we'll see how this unfolds in the location patterns of tech startups. So the final tension that I want to mention is between people and machines. And we're all aware of the danger of robots taking our jobs. I won't go into that. But the makers of autonomous vehicles want to reserve entire city center districts for robot vehicles because the programming is easier and accidents are fewer when human drivers don't have to be taken into account. Do we want this? Are cities for people or for machines? Are cities for people or for machines? Now let's move on to migrations. I just mentioned the creep of the tech campuses into the inner cities and the cycling of their students and employees in and out of the city. Generally, as the US economy has picked up, mobility for employment seeking has resumed in the US. But it's city dwellers who have better access to the information about where the jobs are. The rural folks are still information poor in that regard. International student flows are worthy of mention too. Japan and South Korea are sending fewer students to the USA because their native universities are improving and Western universities are establishing campuses in those Asian countries. Student flow from mainland China to the US continues unabated. There are more than 300,000 Chinese students in the USA in 2016. This is not going to last, though. The students are going to have fewer opportunities to stay in the USA. China wants their knowledge and initiative and can offer the grads good career opportunities back home. China will, however, have greater difficulty attracting foreign researchers and scholars than USA ever did. With no intention to insult our honored Chinese colleagues here in the audience, I believe they would agree that between filthy air and censored internet and tainted food could make Chinese cities very unattractive for researchers and their families. The researchers can find equally stellar salary offers and the better quality of life, for example, in the Gulf Emirates. The movement of inland Chinese to China's coastal cities, mostly a search for employment, has been called the biggest migration in human history. China's challenge now is to reverse that migration. Rising sea levels and fresh water shortages are going to hit the coastal cities hard. Metro Beijing will approach its maximum supportable population of 23 million just a few months from now, and they're already diverting huge amounts of water from far in the interior. Perhaps surprisingly, China is encouraging reverse migration by incentive and not totally by decree. They've built, as I say, hundreds of new inland cities. Some of these cities have employment opportunities Others are what they call ghost cities. Big infrastructure, no people. So there's technological measures, mostly seawalls, also on tap for slowing the inundation of the coastal cities. Bangladeshis, on the other hand, were going to have nowhere to go when sea levels rise. I asked a Chinese government official whether China is ready for a flood of climate refugees from Bangladesh, and he gave me a chilling, rather Trumpian answer. "We have very strong border controls," he said. All right, so what more of this sort is on tap for the future? Urban computing, including the crunching of the big data from sensors and CCTVs, not only to monitor intra-urban movements of people, but to predict them, and even to provide via smartphone incentives for people not to take transit during the peak times. MIT is working with the government of Singapore to build such a system. But the question remains, one that I'm very interested in: will cities or nations lead the way to the knowledge society? It's uncertain. Author Paul Mason writes, and I quote, "The city is going to be the primary venue of change in this process. Cities have stopped eviscerating their centers. Young networked people want to live right in the center, sometimes two or three to a room, because they understand the city is the closest the analog world comes to a network. The city is where the networked individual wants to live, at least for some of their life and for some of their working year or week," end quote. A member of the Danish Parliament has painted a scenario for the World Economic Forum that she titled very provocatively, "Welcome to 2030, to the year 2030. I own nothing, I have no privacy, and life has never been better." Her scenario has the city government driving the smart city as a service model. And yeah, cities may be more attuned and responsive to local needs, but my other European informants tell me that most European cities do not have the authority to act in this way. So we shall see. As always, some technopolis initiatives will succeed, but most will fail. Everybody wants their own Silicon Valley, and very few can have it. Many unfortunate cities will end up in the purgatories called knowledge service clusters, where low-paid knowledge workers attend customer service lines for tech products. Aspects of the smart city as a service have a kind of back-to-the-future flavor. Mobility as a service is a model for movement without ownership. Well, you say that's what taxis are for, and public bike sharing programs. Okay, but for a monthly fee, mobility as a service will provide faster and more flexible options. For example, instant access to taxis, Ubers, buses, bikes, and so on, so that waiting times are reduced and loads are spread out. One presumably very young commentator wrote about communication as a service. Can you imagine, this fellow enthused, communication that's available to you everywhere without carrying a phone in your pocket? So I posted a comment. I said, yeah, some phone booths. But I suppose communication as a service is going to mean smartphone booths that know when you're passing by and route calls to whatever phone you happen to be passing at that moment. Or maybe our phones will be implanted in our heads. I don't know. Well, human frailty means that knowledge can be misapplied. Yeah, the passage to the knowledge society is going to create environmental economies and diseconomies. Here, this is the radioactive plume that spread out from the Fukushima disaster. It's changed the pattern of fisheries. Some of your regional scientists are investigating. I was living in Korea when this happened, and the market for local shellfish skyrocketed, because Koreans didn't want to buy fin fish because those fish may have migrated from the eastern Japanese waters, and they know that the shellfish stayed where they are. But then it turned out that the fin fish from eastern Japan migrate first across the Pacific toward the Americas before coming back and getting near Korea. So once that knowledge spread, people's seafood buying habits changed again. But this is certainly the worst environmental disaster ever, and it changes a lot in terms of markets, patterns of fisheries, and so on. All right, so this is my take on the spatial implications of the knowledge society. I hope I've provided students in the room with ample thesis ideas, and I thank you.
Questions, you can feel free to answer either or neither of the questions, or both. Or
good, thanks.
The first is, in Japan, they still design, produce, and consume new fax machines. I wonder if you could explain why that is. And second, what do you think are the prospects of artificial intelligence in replacing us, namely researchers in regional science?
It's been many years since I spent time in Japan, but if I could speculate that Japanese companies or like Korean companies, there's terribly high inertia, and, get into patterns of ways of doing things, and you have the usual cycle about diffusion of innovation and the reluctance to give up the incumbent technology. So it's a general principle, but why any specific Japanese company would do that, I really can't give you an insight. You're talking about fax machines, right?
Yes.
Okay. I recently had a reunion with an old colleague in Texas who worked for Cisco when the World Wide Web first came out, and she had predicted that soon, in addition to email addresses on our business cards, we would have URLs. But these things happen. Yeah. Okay, are there other questions about?
Replacing us. Researchers.
Replacing
artificial intelligence replacing us. Researchers in regional science.
Well, I think the first thing we need to worry about is superstar professors doing MOOCs and you know, replacing us ordinary profs in that regard. And, yeah, this is going to be a huge, huge displacement. And you know, high-tech executives in the U.S. are talking seriously about a universal basic income. I cannot really understand why the conservative opposition in the U.S. government is so opposed to this. Maybe, again, it's the historical inertia of anti-socialism or something. But to me, when this happens, you know, I talked about muscle workers. When they got displaced by machines, they formed unions, and they're still somewhat influential, but less so. But when the machines start to replace white-collar workers, who, as a group, have a higher voting participation, then the politics will get very ugly, and the only two alternatives I see are some kind of mild socialism, income redistribution, or rioting in the streets and social breakdown. I really can't see a third alternative, so I hope that some people come to their senses about that. Many of us will be out of work, there's no question about it. I don't worry about me, but my kids, you know, worry about them. Sir?
Thanks for your talk, Fred. You only made one mention of three-dimensional printing.
Of what?
Three-dimensional printing.
Oh, yes.
Could you say something about that?
Oh, sure. The distribution of goods and the places where things get manufactured. I don't think I can give you any insight other than the conventional wisdom on that, but what needs to be transported in the future is the raw materials, the gunk that you pour into the top of the machine, and not the finished products. Okay, now, in terms of marketing, I think it has bigger implications, because what does it mean? What would a branded product mean in the future? Maybe Professor Eugene has a better idea than I do about this, but you know, if a brand is supposed to be a signal to the consumer about uniformity of product and quality, and you know, you're making the thing in your spare room instead of letting the manufacturer make it, then you know, for many reasons, I think that the brand as the central concept in marketing is on its way out, and that's one of the reasons.
Hi, I have a question for you. My name is Shen Zhong Chen from National Singapore University. When I listen to your speech, the last official comment coming from my mind that one of the issues that when artificial intelligence gets stronger and stronger, maybe someday later we are driving in an autonomous, we are riding in an autonomous vehicle, and the machine will take our job. So one of my questions is, do we still need such a big space of urban
size? Need for?
Such a big space of urban size, the city getting bigger and bigger is not necessarily a situation that we try to go or we try to avoid. And the ghost town in China is one of the examples, when they were finished the One Belt, One Road construction, and that will become a very huge growth of economics from Asia to the European Union, and city urbanization will get higher from now something like 50% up to 70-80%. So that will be another issue, that the energy consumption will be huge. So we maybe have reached another regional economic situation over the globe, the Earth, but the energy consumption will be reached another issues for example, disaster because of high percentage of urbanization, or what would happen to that when in future? What do you think about this?
Did I understand you correctly? You started by talking about autonomous vehicles and then moved into the One Belt, One Road?
Yeah, that's because the future city was our imagination.
Okay. The makers of autonomous vehicles in the United States, they've sort of followed the Uber model of charging ahead regardless of city ordinances and you know, letting the courts decide later whether what they've done is legal. It's there's been no exercise in what we in our journal would call technology assessment. Very little in the way of surveys about whether people are willing to ride in autonomous vehicles and indeed to trust their lives to autonomous vehicles. And philosophers are worried about the so-called trolley problem, where there are traffic situations where a driver might have to make a choice between saving himself versus saving a child that's running across the road, and are we willing to leave that decision to a machine? There are some very serious obstacles in terms of human reaction to the autonomous vehicles. But the makers would like to make cities based on autonomous vehicles a reality as soon as possible, regardless of all these difficulties. So it's a new kind of problem for diffusion of innovation, because diffusion used to be defined by modest advertising pushes at first and then by demand pull later on. And now we have manufacturers taking advantage of the weakened sovereign state by pushing these things regardless of law. Okay, now, the One Belt, One Road, that, yeah, if China increases trade with Europe, that changes global trade patterns. It increases China's cultural influence over Central Asia. It increases who owes money, it changes who owes money to whom. The NATO members have noticed that China likes to use railroads to move soldiers. So they're wondering about the whole trade and cultural motivations here, and worrying about whether it's a Chinese military motive. But yes, you're right, I skipped very briefly over the implications of the One Belt, One Road, because they're not all about regional science, but my gosh, trade, politics, culture, it's going to have a huge, huge impact. Other people, oh, it's Francis Fukuyama recently wrote that European countries are putting their infrastructure investment into social programs and education. And China's putting all their infrastructure investment into this. Hard infrastructure. And neither Europe nor China seems to have the right balance. There's no point having hard infrastructure if the people aren't educated, and there's no point having highly educated people who can't go anywhere. So, some kind of middle path needs to be found by all the countries in the world.
Denser and denser. that become more and more severe. And then the impact of this concentration of information and knowledge in certain core cities will change the urban systems pretty much. So may I ask both of you about this potential urban system change, your ideas about and the potential for future research. Also, Professor Breed, Berlin.
Well, I did mention that in the so-called platform wars, some cities are emerging as taking the most rents from your telephone apps and so forth. I think the more immediate issue might be the growing importance of city governments and mayors as political figures, as the sovereignty, the importance of nation states is somewhat diminished. And as we have political paralysis in Washington, here the other day you saw the mayor of Chicago repost all the Environmental Protection Agency data on climate change that the Trump administration had forced the EPA to take down. Okay. City mayors are taking initiatives to improve people's lives that the national government absolutely does not. And my own field of study, the Technopolis, we know that except in very tiny nation states like Singapore or maybe Israel, the action is in metropolitan areas, not in states, not in provinces, not in nations, but these things happen in cities. So cities are the dynamic elements in today's geography.
Thank you. May I ask Professor Berlin to give us your insights?
Thanks for asking me. There's a lot of recent research on the interaction in economics, on the interaction of social networks, and in particular in cities, and productivity in innovation. So I recommend that literature. Yves Zanoug has done a lot of work, and there's a lot of work by French economists looking at patent data and how that reflects social networks as well as concentration of researchers in cities. So I'm no expert on this. I've done a bit of work with Masa Fujita on innovation, but it's not location-specific type innovation. We have one paper on culturing diversity and knowledge creation that's basically a two-location model, but there's a great deal of work on social networks in cities and innovation. I recommend that you look at it.
Thank you very much. So, yes, please.
Some speakers to my university to tell us, especially because the parent company of our university, our university is owned by a corporate conglomerate here in Taiwan. They want to learn about blockchain and what it might mean for their future. I frankly don't understand the enthusiasm of people a year or two ago for getting into this, because this is just personal musing and I'm not answering your question, but when I downloaded a Bitcoin wallet, it came with two warnings. One is that you have to keep forever a 30-digit password, and if you ever lose that password, you're screwed. And I thought, what's the probability of being able to do that? And I thought, it's very small. The second thing was the warning, make sure your device is absolutely secure before you download your Bitcoin. And I'm not competent to know whether my device is absolutely secure. I'm not a computer scientist. So I said, nope, no Bitcoin. So now I'm going to play with another blockchain currency alternative and see what I can learn. But right now, I know nothing. Sorry.
Right.
The time is almost 20 past 10, around 11 past 10. We're supposed to finish this session this time. If there's no further questions at the moment, then maybe we can exchange our ideas in another more present opportunity. So thank you very much.
Thank you.